Today we are going to talk about pedigree and purity in dogs, and then the show dogs, but also the performance working dogs. Because there's a, in my opinion, a misconception, to say it briefly, that if you don't have a show type of dog, but more of a performance type of dog, and you prefer performance over form, that you don't have standards, therefore also are not interested in pedigrees or purity of a dog. And I say misconception because, in my opinion, this is not true. And even more to the point, I think it is even more important, but it's only a little bit different. And why is that? For example, if you have a dog that has a different form, performs very well, and more importantly, also inherits the traits to its offspring, you have a gem in your hand. Because for a dog to perform in a show ring, you only need to look pretty. Whereas a dog that needs to perform as a working dog, you need a dog that has great cardiovascular system, more importantly an athletic body, great endurance, strength, and then the things in the mind that you cannot see, such as bravery, determination, courage, grit, and those things are very hard to contain, especially if you have a characteristic that are far off from that from a natural type of canine, such as the wolf. So for example, a wolf, when it gets hurt, it wants to discontinue and live another day. Whereas for example, a terrier, a gripping type of terrier, will try to finish the job regardless and stay until dark, regardless of the damage it takes. You can imagine that it's something in the mind that you cannot see, that you can only keep if you select for it and you keep good records. I'm not saying that you can have a very good complete outcross, but very often those complete outcrosses don't deliver it in the genetic department to inherit it to the next generation. You have to go back again into the line to make sure. So what they do is they purify their dogs on base of performance, but they are not limited, of course, to a certain line, certain breed, a certain look. They are only limited to the performance. But what would you rather have to describe a breed? A breed that looks a certain way, or a breed that can perform a certain way? There's, for example, the name terrier, which implies a dog that goes to ground. If you have a dog that has the look of a terrier but cannot go to ground or doesn't have the mental attributes or the physical attributes to do so, what do you have? Something hollow. Instead, if you have a dog that is able to go to ground but looks a little bit different, you still have the performance and the iteration of the normal application of this board. So that's one, and in order to do so, they keep records of very well performing animals because they want to have better performance in the next generation, or keep the performance of an exceptional animal by line breeding to it. So that's very important to a performance enthusiast, a lot more important than that of a show enthusiast, albeit sometimes show enthusiast wants to have win all the prizes, of course, as well. And more money can be involved, sure. Because especially those show versions, once they have a champion in the show ring, they will often milk it for its credits and then spread those winning chances for a payment, of course. This can also be a part of the working community. Once a dog, a has proven itself. Oftentimes they are retired for work, so that they, especially if they have enormously dangerous work to do, in order to make sure that they are not lost and they are not dying in the harness, in the armor, so to say. It's a Dutch expression. They are not dying doing their job, but instead are able to pass their traits to the next generation again. So that's very important. And then if you look at the purity, I do agree that most show breeds are extreme exaggerations, and oftentimes they are developed by lots of line and inbreeding on those champions every time, as I mentioned. So the genetic diversity, and thereby the purity, as some people might say it, would be higher, but in this case it's purity combined with a lot of genetic defects, whereas there are performance lines of Bull and Terriers that are, in my opinion, at least as pure, a lot more pure, I would say, but they are purified on performance elements. So, as I mentioned, it's very hard to get traits to go on despite all adversity, but by line breeding and sometimes also a little bit of inbreeding, they're able to have higher consistency in the next litters. And what they then do, when they get some inbreeding depression, they go for an out again from another line that is enormously tight line bred very often, and could add to the pool again. And also very often they already know that these two lines have a good click and can supplement each other very well, and then they are brought back in the lines and purified on the line again. So for the example of the American Pitbull Terrier, very often those outs are just other lines of American Pitbull Terrier. For the Working Fell Terrier, those outs are often another breed. So for example, within the Fell Terrier family, so for example a Pratadil with a Lakeland Terrier, or a Border Terrier, or a German Hunting Terrier, or something along those lines. But they can also be bred within the breed. So for example, this little guy is a combination of two Pratadil lines. On the top he's Boot, and on the bottom is Claude bred. So two very renowned Pratadil lines are now combined in this first generation again. So in my opinion, purity, especially if you take into consideration performance and also consistency, can be a lot higher in working breeds, especially in the mindset that they have. Well, I hope this was insightful. Have a great day. The dog on the leash is my almost two-year-old Pratadil Terrier Estacado. Have a great day. In this video we will discuss, is it possible to keep a short-coated dog such as this Pratadil on the leash, or for example another Bull and Terrier, Staffordshire Bull Terrier, American Staffordshire Terrier, Middleton Pitbull Terrier, Irish Staffordshire Bull Terrier, or the likes, in a cold climate, and what to do. First, start off, of course you can do this, but it also depends on what you want. There's a reason that this big coated, heavy coated dogs exist also from a performance setting, but it is because that heavy coat protects them from the elements. So if you want to keep your dog outside and it's a cold climate, this dog is not in his element, of course, with a short coat. But still, it can be done. There are even pit bull farms up to Russia that keep their dogs outside, but they have to provide weather protection. So that will mean that the dog has a place, a residence, where it can go inside once it gets too cold, to protect it from the snow, the cold and the rain. But please keep in mind, if there are longer durations of this cold conditions, or extreme cold even, the dog will be inside a lot. And in this case it will be inside the doghouse, so it won't have a lot of benefits of being outside. So the only reason should be that you have many a dog and you want to keep them on your own facilities. The other thing is, some people even have them on the chain and then provide a dog house, but that is a lot less beneficial on average. Why? Because the dog house is then the only thing where the dog can live. Normally there's not a covered that you often see in kennels. But also when a dog is outside its dog house, it still can be covered from rain, snow, and oftentimes also a lot of wind. So it still has some benefit that it can have a little bit of walking space. Because also oftentimes dogs in kennels don't get to walk. They just do that thing and the excrements are then collected. But in my opinion, to state this very frankly, I don't think it's good to keep short-coated dogs in a very cold climate. And you could, of course, could also keep your dogs on your terrain and that they are able to walk around and also go into their own dog pen when needed. It's more of a protection dog type of task. I don't know if the Bull and Terrier is that type of dog, but could be. Sometimes people also keep the dogs outside to protect against, for example, predators, but there are better dogs for that purpose, especially in cold climates, in my opinion. Another thing, especially if it's very cold, the smaller the dog, so for example, Petterdale is a lot smaller than a Staffordshire Bull Terrier, and Staffordshire Bull Terrier is already a lot smaller than an American Staffordshire Terrier, the easier they will lose the heat, and in this case it's a bad thing. So if you look at animals, and if the same species lives in a warmer climate or in a medium climate and a cold climate, you will see that those that are living in a cold climate are bigger than those that live in a hot or medium climate. And there's a reason for this, because if you are bigger, the relative surface of the body is smaller than when you are as compared to the kilograms of weight that you carry, than when you are smaller than the surface. The relative surface is a lot bigger compared to the relative weight that you have. So this will also mean that it will be easier for a smaller animal to lose heat. Therefore, for example, in desert you find very small subspecies, whereas in the colder climates you can find very big subspecies. That gives them a lot more isolation and therefore better heat management. And that's particularly important when you're living in a cold climate. So even a dog like a Spitzerdale, that's other than the other examples that I mentioned, comes in three coats. So this is the smooth-coated variety. Then you have a broken-coated variety that offers a little bit more also resistance to cold, but just a tad. And you have the long-haired variety that offers a quite a rich and large and also lengthy coat, and that still offers additional protection. But it's not only the top coat that matters, it's also the undercoat. And Petterdale Terriers normally don't have a lot of undercoat. It could be that the long-haired variety has a little bit different undercoat, so a lot more woolly, and that woolly undercoat, that is a lot of the protection. But regardless of that, even the the long-haired Spitzerdels will very often time have troubles in heat management as compared, for example, to an American Staffordshire Terrier, because of simple physics that they are relatively small. So that should also be said. Then there's another option, that you keep your dogs inside with you. And then there's a very good option to keep a Bull and Terrier, a smooth-coated variety, especially in a cold climate, because the dog will just be like humans. We are also very short-coated, as you can see, but you can still manage for this, because you can manipulate the heat of your own residence, and then everything is fine. And still, those dogs will also, don't get me wrong, enjoy the snow and enjoy the cold. They will, but there's a difference when they have their own warm residence, and when you keep them outside all the time and they just have to deal with the cold all the time, and also the heat management. If you do keep your dogs outside, also think about that they very often will need more food to keep the temperature at a steady level, because that also costs a lot of energy to have this heat management in an okay state. So that's something I wanted to talk to you about this morning. This is also a subscriber request that was interested in this specific topic. Look at this beautiful poppies. Hope this helps. Have a great day.